I'm here in Invercargill, New Zealand, also known as Aotearoa, the land of the long white cloud. New Zealand is known for its resilient people. The first inhabitants of New Zealand were the Maori, and today Maori athletes are known for their warrior strength, competing on the world stage. Rower Jade Udu is one such warrior. Competing for New Zealand in the last two Olympics, Jade and his Maori tribe, Ngāi Tahu, who sponsored him to the Olympics, have relied on the ocean as their main source for food. As a freediver from Hawaii, I'm interested to hear about the Maori's connection to the water. I've come to New Zealand to experience traditional Maori cooking and eating, specifically hangi, a traditional Maori food celebration. Now I have something.
Good! That's a really good fish.
Okay. Yay! That was amazing!
Nice.
So, this is something that you've been doing with your dad since you were a kid?
Yeah, well, obviously, but not as good as you. Dad's main reason why I've done a lot of the fishing and diving. So, and effectively, he's passed on his knowledge of what he's learned. That's really how I take the knowledge of being Māori and being at the sea, is just my father's Māori, and he's taught me the sea and what to eat and how to eat it. So I'm an eighth Māori, which is quite a lot still in this day and age. I think I've always enjoyed catching fish. I'd go out and get flounders, blue cod and crayfish, and then bring it back and fillet them. And then we'd just shallow fry them or bake them in the oven.
Yeah, I can just see how this must fuel you, not just athletically, but your soul too, right?
Well, it's definitely played a huge role in my life of getting to where I am.
Right?
All the food and the fish and the power and the crayfish growing up, rather than just eating the same old from the supermarket every day.
Exactly. Jade Uru's family has Olympic rowing in their blood. Jade competed for New Zealand at the 2012 and 2016 Olympics, and his brother Storm competed in the 2008 and 2012 Olympics. And both brothers have won medals at the World Rowing Championships. I've come to visit the Uru household to find out how they've bred such strong rowing talent.
Oh, and this is the Wall of Fame.
And what did it feel like to you to see them at the Olympics?
Oh, I was full of huge pride. And they, it was hugely nerve-wracking as well. Didn't sleep much that week. And you just want them to do well. Probably the first kind of solids that Jade had was crayfish. I made them eat whatever we were eating. Uh-huh. So seafood has always been a big part of our diet.
So the best way to have these blue cod is actually raw. And so we just normally have some lemon and we put a little bit of salt on there.
Everything's fresh.
It looks so fresh.
Every stroke I took, they always knew that Ngāi Tahu was supporting me. They saw something that no one else in New Zealand did, and they said, look, we'll support you. And I think everyone liked the idea that I wasn't just sponsored by a big corporation or a finance company. I was sponsored by a tribe that was directed through me, and effectively Ngāi Tahu is owned by all the people, and all the people were supporting me when I was going to the Olympics.
New Zealand rowing has a fine history in the sport, and there's no reason to think that the new generation that's coming through won't continue that. Last year at the Olympics, New Zealand was second on the medal table. It's great to see an athlete make it to the Olympics. We've had a number, and you always watch them with real interest and pride to know that, you know, you were there when they started.
We are here at Tuahiwi Marae, a meeting place for Jade's tribe, Ngāi Tahu. For the next few days, I'll be eating and sleeping in this sacred place as we prepare for hangi.
Jade's family are sports people. His ancestors were members of parliament for our tribe, so they led the tribe. We can show you the place up there where they're buried. So it's one of the older families in the village. All of the families have grown up on water here, and the creeks and the rivers, because we know that's where the food is. Eels are a big part of our diet, so everyone here now is concentrating on how to get the eels. And Grenville's doing the hangi tomorrow.
Hey, Grenville.
How you going?
Grenville is considered the hangi expert within Naitahu. He has been preparing the hangi since childhood and has over 50 years of experience.
My sisters. I have two sisters, which are the two feathers. My older sister, my younger sister, and then my daughters and their children. So I've got my grandchildren down there.
Could you describe to me what a hangi is?
A hangi is all our kai put in the ground, covered with wet sacking and steamed under our earth for three and a half hours. It's our traditional way of cooking food for a lot of people. You can cook for 25, 10, or you can cook for thousands. It's for the people to have a nice kai. The infusion of all the flavours, the earth, the fire. I always say it's our ancestors before us that cook it, because they are in the ground. So my thing is, they cooked it for us.
What is the Maori name for the eel?
Tuna.
Tuna.
Tuna, yeah. And tonight, we'll show you that, how we catch them in the drains, how they migrate, and how they maybe go through the shingle into the sea. Look at them here, right up here in front of me. You wouldn't think, but there'd be 100 eels maybe in there. And that's all they do. They just twist over each other all day, all night. I can catch them anywhere. The thing is, it's just like... That's them, and that's what we take. I'm passionate about the eel because we've been gathering that all our lives. Those eels we had last night, and that's what they usually come like. I cut them like this on an angle because there's a heart right there.
Okay.
You don't want a bleeder. It usually goes on the top of the backbone, under the backbone. Open them up, grab that, pull that out, and then what you do there, salt and pepper them.
Got it. Cut at an angle. Don't get the heart down like that. There's the heart. And now that, I got the heart. Damn it. Grab that and rip it. Nice.
And that's what a parfait eel looks like.
That looks great.
This tuna here, it's not only used, like I'm saying, to eat. The oil and everything can be used on your body to, like a moisturizer. It's the best for wrinkles, because you never see a wrinkly eel until what? They're dead.
The hangi is ready to be cooked. Hangi is an ancient Maori way of cooking and preparing food.
Right, it's pretty lucky, really, because, you know, they need, particularly males, need to eat lots of food. Many of them struggle to eat enough. So hangi would be good. It's got vegetables, it's got meat for protein, good mix of fat, which is important, because rowers often need those fat reserves to make sure that they maintain their body weight.
I'm back here with Grenville as he takes us through the process.
Well, so far, everyone that I've met in town that knows you as the hangi guys.
When it comes to something like that, they leave it up to me. I don't know why, but it's always left up to one person, and I don't mind that.
Step one, dig a shallow hole. Step two, fill the hole with wood and then with rocks. Step Step 3, light the wood underneath the rocks on fire, allowing the rocks to heat up. Step 4, while the fire gets going, prepare the food. Wrap it up and place it in wire baskets. Step 5. Place the baskets on top of the hot rocks. Cover with wet cloth and bury in the earth. Step 6. Wait while the food cooks. As the food is steamed in the earth for up to 3 hours, take the time to enjoy the company of those around you. Step 7. Open the hangi. When the time comes, carefully remove the layer of earth on top of the baskets and remove the food from the hole. Step 8. Serve. As a free diver, I have great love and respect for the ocean. And from my time spent with Naitahu tribe, I have seen their incredible appreciation for the ocean and how it feeds its people and its top athletes. Their main source of food comes from water. And for them, where there is water, there is food. I've learned that hangi is an important aspect of Maori culture that not only nourishes its people, but also binds its community together.